In June of 1950, Chinese communist agent Zhu Feng is executed in Taipei. In 2001, a photograph of Zhu Feng at her spying trial surfaces. The photo strengthens the resolve of Zhu's daughter, Zhu Xiaofeng, to find her mother's remains. 4 years later, Zhu's stepdaughter in Taiwan is located. The family hopes she knows what happened to Zhu's remains. Unfortunately, she proves unable to help at all. With no clues to guide them, the family's three-year search is on the verge of failure. A memorial service is held each autumn at this memorial park. In 1949, the era known as the White Terror began in Taiwan. It quickly witnessed the executions of more than 4,000 people. Another 100,000 faced persecution. After the memorial ceremony in 2009, Pan Zhen from Shanghai visits a funeral parlor in Taipei. He is seeking the remains of his father, who was a victim of the White Terror. The two names could look similar if written in such a manner. On a chilly winter day, the family of Xiaofeng learns that after 4 years of frustration, there may be a break. Xu Chengmao promises to follow up on a clue. In early 2010, Professor Chu Hongyuan agrees to join the search for Zhu's remains. He wants to help the family, but is also motivated by a desire to investigate the White Terror era. Chu examines the list of unclaimed urns. There are two numbers located above and below the name Zhu Zhanwen. Chu is directed by a funeral parlor worker to a place where most of the unclaimed urns are stored. Not long after his first attempt to locate the urn, Chu fell ill. He jokingly blamed the chilling sight of so many funerary urns for his illness. When he resumes the quest, Chu is joined by two friends. Historian Wang Qingyu and Lei Yuanrong. The latter works with Taipei Mortuary Services Office. They will search an area once used to bury the remains of political prisoners. In 1993, Taiwan is shocked by the discovery of this graveyard for political prisoners. One of the victims is Zeng Meilan's older brother, executed in the 1950s. The location of the remains is unknown. Zeng never ceases his search and even seeks help from neighbors. His neighbor, Xu Guangjin, finds an important clue.
因为他到市场买了那个田螺，田螺他要炒田螺下酒，那客家人的口味就是炒田螺要放一点紫苏，他就想到山上去采一些野生的紫苏，结果到山上就发现，有几根那个小石头，就是那之前曾梅兰有跟他讲说，你如果在墓地里有发现他哥哥的墓冢，要跟他讲，那他就试着去看。拨了一下，看到那个石头上面有刻字，那显然就是墓碑，而且是一个姓徐的。那他想到就是说，曾梅兰他哥哥好像叫徐什么，那他就把这个讯息告诉曾梅兰。
Zeng quickly goes to investigate the site. As the soil is removed, they find the gravestones of four victims executed on the same day, including Zeng's brother. A total of 201 graves are discovered, drawing public attention to events that had slipped from memory. Is Zhu Chenji among the 201 victims? Chu and the others clean the mud and moss-coated markers one by one, but Zhu's name doesn't appear. The failure to find Zhu's remains confuses Lei. He spends days searching the hills for new clues, but his efforts are all in vain.
I was going to say, 蛮感动的，我说这个到底是这么重要吗？其实我当初并不了解这个人物他的背景。
Lei tries to recall everything about the unclaimed urns. He suddenly remembers there are many such urns in another place in Zone 11. It's possible number 77 may be among them. One morning, Lei, Chu, and Wang arrive at the foot of a hill that is not often visited. Lichen covers the ground. It's a deserted place. The lock has rusted.
Okay.
Lei is the first to enter.
亲自去了，我一看，真的傻眼了，600多个，600多个都是用麻布袋装的，而且外面都是用那个油漆啊写上编号，啊写上编号的时候，就是说已经有的已经模糊不清了，
几乎绝望的时候，因为那个他这个进去很小，然后一格每一格里面呢大概有50个，不过都摆乱了，底下大概50个是也乱掉了，然后就一个一个搬，搬到最后出现的就是77号，大概最后5、6个啊，在最里面搬到那里，哎，找到77号，好高兴。
3 months of hard work finally pay off. Zhu is excited beyond words.
我岳母这一听非常高兴，找到了。有一天晚上就给我们打电话，说老人老了以后很天真，说哎，你看我们找到了，赶紧买票上台湾，买船票买飞机票，你看啊，咱赶紧走。
The weather in Beijing in April is still cold. Li meets Zhu for the first time when he comes to the mainland on a short-term academic exchange program. In the evening, they talk about their next steps.
你要解决，就是你找到的东西，你得亲眼所见。
It has also been Chu's own plan. He concurs with Li without hesitation. But during the next 2 weeks, Li hears nothing from Chu. He begins to worry. After being pressed on the matter, Zhu finally admits something unexpected came up during the attempt to verify the urn.
没打开，毕竟还是没有把握，所以就请碟仙再带，就进去看，就把77再拿出来打开一看，哇，糟了，里面写一个男的名字，不是朱成之，完了。
The name on the urn and the number on the bag belong to different people. Zhu continues the search and gradually gets to know more about Zhu's actions. This knowledge motivates him to carry on.
1950年前后啊，这很有意思的一个时代。这个时代在以前没有，在未来可能也没有。这个时代里面，竟然大家为了追求理想到这种程度啊！朱成之是一个非常好的典范。他为的也是一个主义，为了一个党，为了他的那个认为的理想，出钱出力，最后呢卖了生命。哇，这个真了不起！这不是普通人。所以可佩，所以觉得值得。
As Zhu has a new assignment, Lei has to rely on himself. He reviews the list. If Zhu's urn is not in number 77, can it be in number 233?
再回去找那个，然后就找，始终都是找不到，我几乎都没有信心了。
Several hours have passed, and only a few urns are left.
抓到后面真的都快绝望了，剩下一两个。
If they fail Lei again, Zhu's remains may never be recovered. Lei is seeking a miracle.
是不是可不可以显显灵啊？哈，让我再快点找到。不然的话我真的要放弃，我不找了。所以在这一刻就是说让我讲了这句话了以后，我再重新找，真的奇迹就出现了。
Number 233 is a yellowish container and the brim of its lid is worn. The name of Zhu Chenji is found on it. Lei lets Chu double check it to ensure it's not a mistake.
这盖子一打开的就是骨骸没有多少个，大概只有少许的骨骸，然后盖子上面就写得清清楚楚，就是郑恺写的那个朱成之本身的名字，所以我们俩就很确定这个就是，我就很肯定的跟教授讲说，这就是朱成之的骨骸。
It's now summer in 2010. The family of Zhu Chenji and those who have devoted so much time to helping them can finally relax. The 7-year search is over. But the excitement fades quickly as Li realizes there is a new problem. He needs to get permission to bring the remains home. Li writes to Chu to congratulate him and hopes he can apply for possession of the urn on Li's behalf. Chu goes to work on submitting the application. He obtains a document verifying that Zhu's urn is kept by the mortuary services office. Great difficulties, however, still await him.
这个时候我意识到，这个时候依靠台湾的朋友是不行了，要依靠我们自己了。
Their first step is to get a notarized certificate identifying the relationship between Zhu Feng and Zhu Xiaofeng. Without it, they cannot apply for the urn. Though it seemed an easy task, they struggled to obtain it.
他是当年做秘密工作派遣过去，他的身份证件甚至于姓名都是假的，他更不会证明他有子女在大陆，也不会证明他大陆子女是谁，什么都没有。
Zhu used the name Zhu Jing for her mission to Taiwan. This name is the one printed on her identification.Zhu Xiaofeng needs to get all the necessary documents notarized in Nanjing, where she lives. But she's in the army, and her personal records are hard to get.
始终在强调女儿请妈妈回家这个主题。这个主题你说不感人吗？几十年了，女儿也80多岁了，再不把妈妈请回来。连见妈妈骨灰盒的最后一瞬间的可能性都没有，想尽办法去以情感人，给公安处的朋友去讲故事，就又不敢讲得太白，就跟他们交代，这是一件非办不可的大事，这是一件办成了以后一定是一件很大很大的好事，就这样去感动人家，然后呢一步一步去做。
With the help of his friends, Li finally gets the relationship certificate. He is now able to apply to Taiwan for the trip to retrieve Zhu's urn. But his application to visit is rejected.
结果是，你去不了台湾，还有限制。这个，就是军政人员不行。恰恰朱小凤是军人。
Several months pass, and the need to find a way to get the urn home becomes more urgent. Xiaofeng had recently undergone surgery, and it begins to affect her. She's forgotten almost everything except her mother's urn. It's more urgent than ever for Li to retrieve Zhu's remains. It's a sensitive issue that cannot be handled publicly. Li eventually gets in touch with a Taiwan-based company. Sino Life Group is a Kaohsiung-based funeral provider and also a member of the China Funeral Association.
海基海学的两会的一个有一个制度，让老兵回家，过去哈，那当然我们之前也帮忙过有几个往生者，也很平安顺利的回内地，所以我们公司是有经验的。 掉了以后的当下，刚好有路边的人，善心人士捡到了一个这个小包裹，哎，这个善心人士呢就立刻打电话到我们公司来，因为收件人会留下电话号码，我的秘书潘小姐呢，她一听到电话，哇，吓了一身冷汗，赶快跑去见这个善心人士。
On the 8th of December in 2010, Zhu's remains arrive at the mourning hall of Sino Life Group. The following day, she is to return home. On December 9th, a plane from Taipei lands in Beijing. Zhu's remains arrive back in China without fanfare. At the airport, Liu presents the urn to Zhu's granddaughter, Xu Yunchu, and her husband, Li Yang. The fallen hero of a turbulent time in China's history returns to the embrace. After 60 years in a forgotten corner, Zhu's lonely soul is home. In July of 2011, Zhu's remains are buried in her hometown. After their long separation, Zhu Xiaofeng is finally close to her mother she had little chance to know as a child.